Thank you for joining us for our online Good Friday service. This year's service will be different from most years. However, youth are still involved by doing their readings and taking photos for the video. We are sorry that we cannot be together right now, but we trust in God's ability to bring good from this difficult situation. Please pray with us.
Almighty God, look with loving mercy on your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed, to be given over to the hands of sinners, and to suffer death on the cross, who now lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be exalted and lifted up, and shall be very high. Just as there were many who were astonished at him, so marred was his appearance beyond human semblance, and his form beyond that of all mortals. So he shall startle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him, for that which had not been told them they shall see, and that which they had not heard they shall contemplate. Who has believed what we have heard, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed. For he grew up before him like a young plant and like a root out of a dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by others, a man of suffering and acquainted with infirmity. As one from whom others hid their faces, he was despised, and we held him of no account.
Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases, yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have all turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all.
He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By a perversion of justice he was taken away. Who could have imagined his future? For he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. They made his grave with the wicked and his tomb with the rich, although he had done no violence and there was no deceit in his mouth.
Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him with pain. When you make his life an offering for sin, he shall see his offspring and shall prolong his days. Through him the will of the Lord shall prosper. Out of his anguish he shall see light. He shall find satisfaction through his knowledge. The righteous one, my servant, shall make many righteous. He shall bear his inequalities. Therefore, I will allot him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong. Because he poured out himself to death, he was numbered with the transgressors, and yet he bore sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors.
For our transgressions, he was crushed for our sins. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. And by his wounds we are healed. He was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our sins. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. And by his wounds we are healed. We are healed by your sacrifice. Let the life that you gave, we are healed. For you paid the price. By your grace we are saved. We are saved.
He was pierced for our transgressions and crushed for our sins. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him.
And by his wounds we are healed. We are healed by your sacrifice. Let the life that we are healed, for you paid the price. By your grace we are saved. We are saved.
He was
was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our sins. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. And by his wounds we are healed. And by his wounds, what can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Jesus went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to a place where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, because Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas brought a detachment of soldiers together with police from the chief priests and the Pharisees, and they came there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to happen to him, came forward and asked them, "Whom are you looking for?" They answered, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus replied, "I am he." Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they stepped back and fell to the ground. Again he asked them, "Whom are you looking for?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. So if you are looking for me, let these men go." This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken, "I did not lose a single one of those whom you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword back into its sheath. Am I not to drink the cup that the Father has given me?" So the soldiers, their officer, and the Jewish police arrested Jesus and bound him. First they took him to Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest that year. Caiaphas was the one who had advised the Jews that it was better to have one person die for the people. Simon Peter and other disciples followed Jesus. Since that disciple was known to the high priest, he went with Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest. But Peter was standing outside at the gate. So the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out, spoke to the women who guarded the gate, and brought Peter in. The women said to Peter, "You are not also one of the man's disciples, are you?" He said, "I am not." Now the slaves and the police had made a charcoal fire because it was cold, and they were standing around it warming themselves. Peter was also standing with them and warming himself.
Then the high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his teaching. Jesus answered, "I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in synagogues and in the temple, where all the Jews come together. I have said nothing in secret. Why do you ask me? Ask those who have heard what I said to them. They know what I said." When he had said this, one of the police standing nearby struck Jesus on the face, saying, "Is that how you answer the high priest?" Jesus answered, "If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?" Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. They asked him, "You are also not one of his disciples, are you?" He denied it and answered, "I am not." One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked, "Did I not see you with him in the garden?" Again, Peter denied it, and at the same moment, the cock crowed. Then they took Jesus from Caiaphas to Pilate's headquarters. It was early in the morning. They themselves did not enter the headquarters so as to avoid ritual defilement and to be able to eat the Passover, so Pilate went out to them and said, "What accusations do you bring against this man?" They answered, "If this man were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you." Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and judge him accordingly to your law." The Jews replied, "We are not permitted to put anyone up to death." This was to fulfill what Jesus had said to them when indicated the kind of death he was to die.
Then Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus, and asked him, "Are you the King of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?" Pilate replied, "I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here." Pilate asked him, "So you're a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." Pilate asked him, "What is the truth?" After he said this, he went out to the Jews again and told them, "I find no case against him, but you have a custom that I release someone for you at the Passover. Do you want me to release for you the King of the Jews?" They shouted in reply, "Not this man, but Barabbas." Now Barabbas was a bandit. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged, and the soldiers wove a crown of thorns and put on his head, and they dressed him in a purple robe. They kept coming up to him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews," and striking him on the face. Pilate went out again and said to them, "Look, I am bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no case against him." So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, "Here is the man." When the chief priests and the police saw him, they shouted, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Take him yourself and crucify him. I find no case against him." The Jews answered him, "We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die because he has claimed to be the Son of God."
Now when Pilate heard this, he was more afraid than ever. He entered his headquarters again and asked Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave him no answer. Pilate therefore said to him, "Do you refuse to speak to me? Do you not know I have the power to release you and power to crucify you?" Jesus answered him, "You would have no power over me unless it had been given to you from above. Therefore the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin." From then on, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out, "If you release this man, you are no friend of the emperor. Everyone who claims to be a king sets himself against the emperor." When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus outside and sat on the judge's bench at a place called the Stone Pavement, or in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation for Passover, and it was about noon. He said to the Jews, "Here is your king." They cried out, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" Pilate asked them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but the emperor." Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross by himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, which in Hebrew is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others on either side, with Jesus between them. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, in Latin, and in Greek. Then the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, "Do not write 'The King of the Jews,' but 'This man said, I am the King of the Jews.'" Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." Then the soldiers had crucified Jesus. They took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one for each soldier. They had also taken his tunic. Now the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top. So they said to one another, "Let's not tear it, but cast lots for it to see who will get it." This was to fulfill what the scripture says,
"They divided my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots." And that is what the soldiers did. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, "In order to fulfill the scripture, I am thirsty." A jar full of sour wine was standing there, so they put a sponge full of the wine on the branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit.
Since it was the day of preparation, the Jews did not want the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath, especially because that Sabbath was a day of great solemnity. So they asked Pilate to have the legs of the crucified men broken and the bodies removed. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out. He who saw this has testified, so that you also may believe. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth. These things occurred, so that the scripture might be fulfilled: "None of his bones shall be broken." And again, another passage of the scripture says, "They will look on the one whom they have pierced." After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, though a secret one because of his fear of the Jews, asked Pilate to let him take away the body of Jesus. Pilate gave him permission to do so. So he came and removed the body. Nicodemus, who had at first come to Jesus by night, also came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and wrapped it in the spices of linen cloths, according to the burial custom of the Jews. Now there was a garden in the place where he was crucified, and in the garden there was a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. And so, because it was the Jewish day of preparation, the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there.
The nail is used for many things. A useful securing tool, a hammer is taken by the hand and drives it. That's the rule. A nail is needed when you build. It's a necessary thing. It was also used over 2,000 years ago to hang upon a tree, the king. He took the pain and suffering for all mankind, you see. Yet he took the torture just for you, and he took it just for me.
You cannot keep a good man down, through the years many have said. He went down a man and rose a king to deliver the spiritually dead. He is on the throne at God's right hand, the first, the last, the great I am. No nail, no hammer can touch him now, the mighty King on high. What he built is forevermore salvation for you and I. So when you see a simple nail with its sharpened end and need to build or repair, lift up your eyes, your heart and mind, and thank him with a prayer.
Why are the faces of some hurts him more than he shows. Daddy, please, can't you do something? He looks as though he's gonna cry. You said he was stronger than all of those guys. Daddy, please tell me why. Why does everyone want him to die? Later that day, the sky grew cloudy, and Daddy said I should go inside. Somehow he knew things would get stormy. Boy, was he right. But I could not keep from wondering if there was something he had to hide. So after he left, I had to find out. I was not afraid of getting lost, so I followed the crowds to a hill where I knew men had been killed. And I heard a voice come from the cross, and it said, Father, why are they screaming? Why are the faces of some of them beaming? Why are they casting their lots for my robe? This crown of thorns hurts me more than it shows. Father, please, can't you do something? I know that you must hear my cry. I thought I could handle a cross of this size. Father, remind me why. Why does everyone want me to die? Oh, when will I understand why? My precious son, I hear them screaming. I'm watching the face of the enemy beaming. But soon I will clothe you in robes of my own. Jesus, this hurts me much more than you know. But this dark hour, I must do nothing. Though I've heard your unbearable cry, the power in your blood destroys all of the lies. Soon you'll see past their unmerciful eyes. Look there below, see the child trembling by her father's side. Now I can tell you.